Well, good morning. Welcome to Redemption Church. My name is Josh, one of the pastors here. Thank you for joining us this morning to orient yourself around the good news of who Jesus is and what he has done. Certainly want to extend an extra welcome to those of you who are visiting with us this morning or have the last few weeks but are new to the church and are checking us out to discover not only what we believe but our culture and discerning perhaps God's will for where you would land and call your church home and your church family. The search is over. You've arrived. Thus says the Lord. No, take all the time you want. We don't want to pressure you into obeying God's will, but as you are seeking his decision for you, we definitely want to make that as easy and as accessible as possible. Unfortunately, there is some mistaken views out there when it comes to a church that that this would be a place where only the godly gather, that the church is not a place where sin should be found and where sinners are not welcome. I hope you don't think that, whether you're new or a longtime member of our church, that the church is to be a place where the person of Jesus Christ is front and sinner because he is the one that brings us to God, that his life is the only sinless life that has ever been lived. It is his death alone that is sufficient to provide for the forgiveness of our sins, and it is through his resurrection from the dead that we have the hope, not of a changed life, but a completely new life. That we are sinners, and we gather as sinners around the person of Christ as our rescue and as our hope. And he gives us the confidence to keep going. And so you've come hopefully to be reminded of that, or perhaps to hear and trust that for the first time. It's with that in mind, you can go ahead and stand. I'm going to read Psalm 103, a song written by a very notorious sinner named David. And because of his great sin and his great need, he put down in writing the great deliverance and solution that God has offered him. Because the Lord is merciful and gracious, he's slow to anger, he's abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. Praise God. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. So that's what we are celebrating this morning. So let's sing loud and passionately and together as we think on that. Welcome.
Sound. First Peter chapter 2, this is a passage talking about submission and being shared with Christ in that and in suffering. And this is the example that we have from him. It says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but you have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. So we are going to sing a song that really depicts the physical moment, the physical scene of Christ's death. And I hope that as we sing that, we can really be focused and aware on both that physical reality and the spiritual reality, that Christ dying, the Son of God dying this brutal death, was the only way that we could be reconciled to God. That was the only punishment that would be worthy of our sin against God. And so not only does the cross show us how seriously God takes our sin and how indebted we are, but it also shows us how much he loves us, that he made the sacrifice for us. So let's praise him together.
His body bowed.
Amen. Because of that sacrifice, we are all family to one another. So let's greet one another this morning.
Oh, that was so much fun. Oh, thank God. Oh, thank God. Oh, my name is Rory. I'm one of the pastors here, and we are going to transition now into our time of pastoral prayer, which each one of the pastors here carries a different sort of vibe and flavor of the week, I guess you could say. My intention with every pastoral prayer is that they are corporate in nature, which means though I'm the only one audibly praying, it's our prayer. Corporate prayer is a very mysterious, biblical kind of thing because though you say nothing, I say everything, it's all of us together praying for the same exact thing, which is a lot of responsibility and a lot of trust on your part, but ultimately God gets the glory. We get the joy, and in so doing we are strengthened as a body. And so if you would join me, bow your heads, and I'll lead us in prayer to our Heavenly Father. Almighty God, yours is the name above every name. Yours is the kingdom from everlasting to everlasting. Your steadfast love endures forever, and all creation shouts forth your praises. And if we were to remain silent, then you would make even the rocks cry out to you. You alone are worthy of all honor, all praise, all splendor, all majesty, all authority, and all glory. We readily and willingly admit our failure to rightly acknowledge who you are, what you have done, how you have blessed, and why you are worthy of such praise. Our minds are filled with the cares of this world. We focus our anxious thoughts on things we cannot control. We spend our limited energy on tasks we cannot accomplish, and we make our selfish plans for things that we cannot justify. In this moment, we pause and we reflect upon our complete and total dependence upon you. We take this time to confess our need for you, Lord, and we lay our sins before you. We acknowledge that we have spent too much time, too much energy, too much desire, too much planning, and too much pursuing of things that won't bring us joy. And in our pursuit of all these things we think will bring us joy, we neglect the one true source of infinite joy, you. And yet, you happily, readily, willingly, and quickly receive us right now as your children. Our sin does not separate us from your love in any way because your love is greater than any and all of our sins ever could be. For we know that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so, Father, we thank you for the privileged position we have as adopted sons and daughters of God. We thank you for never leaving us nor forsaking us. We thank you for all of your promises finding their yes and amen in Christ Jesus, your Son. And we receive the fresh forgiveness of our sins and the restored fellowship of our spirits with your Holy Spirit. And now, Lord, we ask for your help. We ask that we would pursue joy, not in the things that are passing away, that we might not slip into the bad habits that bring us only farther from you, but that we might put to death the deeds of the body and bring to life the fruit of the Spirit. And we will do this only by your grace that you have so lavished upon us all. We bless your name for your glory and our joy. And all the people of Redemption Church together said, Amen.
If you can't tell already, you're going to find that you will rarely have things addressed as straightforwardly and as deep at a heart level as you do at this church. In all likelihood, today, already in the moments that we've been together, you have heard discussed, sang, announced, prayed things about God and His greatness and His weight, His significance, His supremacy, His glory, as explicit as you have anywhere all week. You've been confronted that we are sinners in need of a Savior as directly, perhaps, as you have anywhere all week. That's as it should be, because we come every week to be reminded again of who we are, who God is, and what He has done for us completely and in a finished way in the person and work of Jesus Christ. And we do that around the Scriptures, the Bible. We believe that this book is alive and that when we read it and hear it preached, it is not simply a word that God has spoken, although it is that, but it is God actively speaking to us. Again, to confront us, to remind us, to cleanse us, to encourage us and give us hope in Christ, and to give us confidence as we keep going. And so in our study that we've been in since this past fall in the book of Acts, we're coming to some verses in which the Word of God is speaking today to each of us and to us corporately about a couple of sins that are just ugly to the bone. And God does this because He cares for us and He loves us. I'm talking about the sin of prejudice and discrimination. And you living in this country don't need to be told that that's an issue. We live in a country in which that was one of many original sins of our nation, and we continue to live with some of those consequences to this day. And so it's natural that when I said prejudice and discrimination, you thought racial prejudice and discrimination, and that's real, but it's not limited to that kind, and it's not limited to our country or our times. You will find it anywhere you find the human heart. It's a universal problem. Apparently, it was an issue even in the first century church that we read about in the book of Acts. And since this can be an explosive and controversial and easily misunderstood or caricatured sin, I want to be careful and spend a little bit of time defining what I mean when I throw those terms around. What I mean when I say discrimination is any kind of unfair preference of one person over another. Or instead of unfair, I might say any sinful preference of one person over another. The key word in that sentence is unfair and sinful. Because we all discriminate on a regular basis in a way that's not unfair and sinful. When you chose what you're wearing today, out of all the clothes you have in your closet, you discriminated and chose. When you picked a spouse, you discriminated against all the other people that you weren't going to marry and married that person. I don't mean it that way. So when I talk about it this morning, I mean any sinful, unfair preference of discrimination toward people. It happens almost automatically, and many times we don't even realize we're doing it or why. Underneath discrimination is prejudice. And the definition of that is in the word, to prejudge sinfully or unfairly so that you then act sinfully discriminate. I wrote a sentence back when we went through the book of James when we were dealing with this issue, and it took me about half an hour to write it because I wanted to be so clear. And so I'm going to read it. This is what I mean by discrimination and prejudice. Based on external appearance or past experiences or personal preferences, our sin nature assumes the worst of others. Our sinful mind forms bad opinions of them so that we, as a result, say, do, or ignore unjust, cruel, and even hateful things. Read it again. Based on external appearances, past experiences, or personal preferences, our sin nature assumes the worst of others. Our sinful mind forms bad opinions of them, so that we say, do, or ignore unjust, cruel, and even hateful things. Now, who we're going to do that toward, I think is learned. I don't think people are born hating other races. We're born sinners, but I don't think we're born hating other races. I don't think that Southern rednecks and Northern Yankees are born suspicious of one another. I don't think heterosexuals are born mocking homosexuals. I think that as our lives are lived, our sinful nature learns in our homes, in our schools, among our peer groups, in our culture, perhaps even in our churches. We learn to gain prejudices and begin to discriminate. And we learn the words to express them and the symbols and the jokes that go along to reinforce it. And because that's true, we need to talk about it. Especially as Christians in this place, of all places, where it has no place belonging. But let's face it, and I have no person in mind, I don't need to, because every single one of us harbors some prejudice. And every time we do that, or feel that, or express that, it's sinful. You can't get any more explicit than James 2, verse 9. He calls it partiality. There's no getting around it. If you show partiality, you are committing sin. Not a whole lot of wiggle room. It may be in the area of race, but it may be any other thing. women could be prejudiced or discriminate against men, and men versus women. Different parts of the country, different countries toward other countries. You can be prejudiced about people who vote differently than you vote, or raise their kids different than you raise yours, or choose schooling for them in an altogether different way than you've chosen to educate your kids. Prejudice can come out in regards to lifestyles or experiences. You can be prejudiced towards those who are addicted or divorced or experiencing a gender dysphoria. The problem isn't that you have difference of opinions or different preferences or different backgrounds and different experiences or even different theological convictions. Of course you do. Fine. But when you're dealing with and viewing and approaching people who are on the other side of those things, do you treat them less than, inferior, not worthy of respect or honor or dignity? The word that seems to be going around a lot, I probably don't agree with all that that's involved in it, but it does kind of get at it in a more broad, general way that I like. It's othering. You treat them as other. You treat them with contempt. You treat them as not worthy to be in your circle, your group. I'll confess, God has, in the last number of years, been exposing in me a prejudice of how I view those that I consider emotionally weak or needy. And I can be prejudiced toward those who I've assessed as that. All this brings us to Peter in Acts chapter 10, a man who was prejudiced. And he was a leader in the local church, writer of Scripture. There's no doubt, he's a great man, a godly man, a man we should love, a man that has much to teach us as a model to follow. But like us, he was a sinner and had parts of his life that were in process and needed dealt with. And in Acts, we get to, aren't you glad God's not writing Scripture today about you and your issues? In Acts chapter 10, we get to learn about it. It's helpful regularly in this book to orient ourselves, so let me quickly do that. First, chronologically, when you come to Acts 10, you're 6 years after the crucifixion of Jesus. So the church has been growing and multiplying and deepening for 6 years, and Peter has been a big part of that. Geographically, there are two cities involved in this story that will start this week and I'll finish next week. The first city is called Joppa. We first were introduced to it last week in chapter 9, in verse 43, you can see it there. Peter is staying in Joppa. And then in chapter 10, verse 1, the other city is Caesarea. Both are coastal towns along the Mediterranean Sea. Caesarea in the north, Joppa in the south, about 31 miles separate them. But more important to the context of the passage than the geography and the chronology is the theology, the theological context involved. I want you to track with me. This will be perhaps new to some of you and heavy sledding and can be complex. You might even have some questions I'd be more than happy to talk with you about if you have them. But when we read in your Christian Bible the first 39 books called the Old Testament, we learn that when God institutes His plan of salvation for the whole world, He begins by pure grace, selecting out from among the mass of humanity a man named Abraham. And Abraham will be the man that He begins to work through to lay the foundation of his salvation plan and to be a model and a picture through which the whole world will ultimately be reached. And Abraham becomes a family, and that family becomes a nation called Israel, and that nation begins to be viewed and view themselves ethnically and racially as Jews. And the whole point of their being chosen for that role was not based on their giftedness or their intellect or their righteousness. It was so that in their day and in the following generations and nations, that we would see that what God did in that man's life and that family's experience and in that nation's development, God can do with anyone. But if a person is going to come to God and be in a right relationship with God, it's going to be a grace relationship. But it's in that sense that they rightly and biblically thought of themselves, and we could speak of them as being a chosen race. But as time passed over the course of years and centuries, they began to believe and to feel and to think and to teach that since they were a chosen people, they were a superior people. That little Jewish boys and girls were taught that any other race, generically referred to as Gentiles, were unclean. They were far off. They were outside. They were other. And they even were referred to as uncircumcised dogs. And you don't play with other little boys and girls that aren't Jewish. And you don't go into their houses and you don't have them over to yours. And you dress different and you talk different. And you don't eat the same kind of foods that they eat. And on it went. And these generation after generation were taught the stuff, the slurs, the jokes, the phrases, and how they were of a privileged status. Peter grew up like that. He learned that. In a sense, he lived like that. And as you can imagine, some of you who grew up in prejudiced cultures or homes or families, those things run deep. They're hard to shake. And so as God begins to not only continue to proclaim it's his heart for the nations, not just one, but all the nations, all the peoples, in the book of Acts, he's starting to call in the chips. He's not just promising, he's empowering, and it's starting to take place. That the Old Testament, in which the people of God was predominantly Jewish, with a minority Gentile within, remnant within, starts to begin to transition over into where the Gentiles begin to number as many as the Jews, all the way till today, we would say that the church, God's chosen people, is now predominantly Gentile with a remnant of Jewish ethnicity among it. Now, Romans 11, and it's a bigger topic than what I'll deal with today, Paul writes that there's coming a day in which the numbers will begin to even out. But for a Jew, this was threatening. Look how Luke in verse 1 doesn't allow us to escape the racial component. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of what was known as the Italian cohort. That is a verse that is just dripping with Gentilishness, if I can coin a word. Caesarea is named after Caesar. Jerusalem is a city named after the King of Righteousness, the capital of the Jews. Caesarea is named after the king of the great one, Caesar. Caesarea is in the Jewish state of Palestine, and it operated as the provincial capital of the state. It was the representative city and practically the city in which Rome oversaw the Jews. The Roman prefect lived there. There was a large military presence there. It was inhabited predominantly by Gentiles. It represented everything that a Jew resented about Romans' presence in their life. So Caesarea. And then there's this Gentile Roman name, Cornelius. And he's a centurion, which is a leader of 100 within a cohort, which numbered 600. So there were 6 centurions within a cohort. And he's among the Italian cohort. So if you're of a Jewish mind and a Jewish background, there is nothing to like about Acts 10:1. But look at God's verdict. This Cornelius was a devout man. He feared God, 4 things. He was devout. He feared God with all his household. He gave alms generously to the people. And he prayed continually to God. Centurions were chosen because of their depth of character and the honor and the respect that they had, not only of their men, but in the community. And that wasn't just a Roman assessment. In fact, you want to do a little quick study, get a concordance out this week and look up the word centurion in the New Testament. You meet a number of them and then go and read about them. All of them are good men. All of them are good men. And this guy's not only a good man, he's a God-fearer, which is a Jewish title for a Gentile who had become dissatisfied with the Roman gods, the many of them that they were, and had chosen to devote his life and his worship and his study and his pursuit of the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They weren't fully converted. They weren't circumcised. But they were allowed to enter the temple for worship and prayer and reading just so long as they stayed in that divided part of the temple called the Court of the Gentiles. And apparently Cornelius did that, because in verse 3 it says about the 9th hour of the day, he clearly saw a vision. The 9th hour would be 3 p.m. That's the hour of prayer. If you look at Acts 3, remember Peter and John went to the temple at the 9th hour, which was the hour of prayer. So he would go and do that. Apparently he's a good spiritual leader of his home, because all of his household is are God-fearers. He gives alms generously to the people. Alms isn't just giving charitable money to those in need. Alms is charitable giving to Jewish people in need. So he's seeking the one true God of the Jewish faith. But being a good man isn't sufficient to bring you to God. Being sincere in pursuing the one true God, while a great thing to place to start, that's not enough to have your sins forgiven and be given eternal life. Being a good dad, being a good husband, being a good employee, being well respected in your city, that's not sufficient to be saved. We know that God has said that it is by grace alone you are saved, not through works. It is by grace alone, through faith alone. It is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Jesus Christ alone. Peter has said there is no other name under heaven by which men can be saved than Jesus Christ. Cornelius doesn't know that. But Peter knows that. And so while he's praying, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God come in and say to him, Cornelius. And he stared at him in terror and said, "What is it, Lord?" And he said to him, "Your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. I see them. I remember them. I'm recognizing them. You're responding to the light you have. And I recognize that. Now send men to Joppa and bring one Simon." And there are going to be two Simons there. And he's the one who's called Peter. And he's lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. And even though he doesn't know Peter, he's not even given the reason to do that. Look at his immediate obedience. When the angel who spoke to him had departed, he called two of his servants and a devout soldier. So apparently he was even a leader of his soldiers in their faith, a devout soldier from among those who attended him. And having related everything to them, he sent them to Joppa. Now, having gotten these guys on the journey, God is going to work on the other end of the story with Peter. They don't know Peter. They just have heard his name, and they know that they're supposed to go get him, but they don't know anything about him. Peter doesn't even know they exist and are coming toward him yet. He's never heard of Cornelius. He's never read Acts 10, verses 1 through 8. But God, who is omniscient and omnipresent, is going to prepare Peter for this next step. So in verse 9, while they're on their way, the next day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the housetop about the sixth hour to pray. So he's praying too, and that would be if the ninth hour is 3 p.m., then the sixth hour is noon. Good math. You got it. And so he's praying the next day, which is lunchtime, and a little preacher's imagination here, but what we know about where Peter's been, what we know about Joppa, what we know about the mission of the church, and Peter particularly, what's he doing? He's up on this roof. He's just come off of two miraculous healings and people coming to faith in great number in Lydda and Joppa. Great success. The ministry of Jesus Christ is expanding and multiplying and growing. And he's overlooking this beautiful Mediterranean Sea. You got to think if he's praying, he's saying, "God, let's keep this thing going. Thank you for the fruit that we're seeing in the spread of the gospel. And as I look out over this ocean, there are other peoples, there are other places that I want to see come to know Christ, and I want to be a means by which they come to Christ." And Peter has no idea, but God is saying, "Me too. In fact, there are some people coming your way, and if you want what I want, and I think you do, you're going to have to overcome some prejudice. You're going to have to overcome some cultural, sociological, even theological barriers that run deep. You're going to have to overcome your fears." And so, in verse 10, he became hungry and wanted something to eat. While they were preparing it, he fell into a trance. I don't know if that's a living vision or prayer. I tend to think it's prayer. I've fallen asleep a number of times praying. If I'm praying at night, it's very common that I'd fall asleep as I do it. I pray first thing in the morning before my feet ever hit the floor, not very long, and I can't tell you how many times I've done that, and I've sort of snoozed back in the middle of prayer. Perhaps he's doing that, because I think God is using his visible waking environment as a vivid image to make a theological point. He's hungry. So God uses the imagery of food to get across the theological point. Perhaps there's a leather awning that has been stretched taut over the roof to provide shade. Or perhaps he looked down on the seashore where Simon the tanner would be drying out and spread out animal skins. He's been praying, "God, I want you to reach more and more people." So God brings all that together so that as he's sleeping, he sees the heavens opened and something like a great sheet descending, being let down by its four corners upon the earth, which you read that and you think the four corners of the world. And in it were all kinds of animals and reptiles and birds of the air. And you you read that as a Gentile and you think, well, what's the big deal? Well, how Gentile of you. Jews then and even today are meticulous about what they eat and what they don't eat. And it's not because of their desire for health or weight gain. It's theological. They have Bible verses from the law of Moses that say one of the physical markers that will set you off apart from the other nations as my people will be dietary markers. There will be animals that are clean and unclean. And based on Peter's response, there are apparently animals on that sheet that are unclean. So there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Gross. No. And so Peter does something that he does way too often when it comes to Jesus saying things to him. Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. I'll never eat it. Lord, sovereign over all of my life." That's called an oxymoron. "No, great sovereign who's in charge of me." If you know your Gospels, you know that Peter does this a lot. One time's in Matthew chapter 16, when Jesus was telling his disciples as he was getting closer to the cross, and he said, "The time is coming where I will be killed and 3 days later raised from the dead." That the plan of salvation, the next thing in the kingdom of God, is going to be for me to die. And Peter privately, respectfully, pulls Jesus aside and says, "I don't want to ever hear that again. You will never die." Jesus doesn't back down for a second. He says, "Get behind me, Satan, because you are putting the way you think and feel and act and what you would do in the way I would do them. You get in line." Peter rightfully repents and gets in line. The next time's in John 13, the night of Jesus' betrayal and arrest, and Jesus has gathered his close friends into an upper room to have a final meal, and he begins to wash their feet. And he comes to Peter, and Peter says, "You will never wash my feet." In the Greek, it's eisinon. "You will never into eternity ever wash my feet," is the idea. Peter doesn't back down. Jesus doesn't back down. It says, if you don't let me do this, you'll have no part with me. Again, Peter's all in. "Well, then wash my hands, my head, everything. Just give me a bath." Jesus, "No, you don't need a bath. You know, once bathed, always bathed. You just need your feet washed, cleaned up here." And so he does that. A little bit later, in the conversation, Jesus tells those 12, same meal, "One of you will betray me." Peter looks around the room and says, "Won't be me. How about you guys? I'll never deny this guy." Jesus looks him in the eyes and says, "You're right. It won't be you who betray me. And you won't do it once. You'll do it three times." Three times. Graciously, God confronts Peter post-resurrection, confesses his sin, restores him back into leadership. And now, 6 years later, Peter is not only in the group, he's a leader among the group. Now he's even indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and yet now he's still saying to Jesus, "Never will I eat bacon." Whew. He does need to repent of that, doesn't he? Jesus isn't going to back down here either. Verse 15, Jesus said to him a second time, "What God has made clean, do not call common." I decide what's clean and what's not clean and what you'll do. This happened three times. So it's back and forth. We're not told all the details, but after the third time, then the sheet was taken back up to heaven, and the voice stops speaking, almost as if Jesus is saying, that's enough. Remember what happened last time? We went three deep, Peter. He leaves. Look at how verse 17, prejudice so dulls our mind. Now, while Peter was inwardly perplexed as to what the vision that he had seen might mean. What are you talking about? What's there to be perplexed about? It's a vivid vision. Peter, rise and eat. Those aren't hard words to understand. He says it three times. In Mark, Jesus had already declared unclean foods clean. Now he's reminding him of it. This isn't hard. There's nothing to be perplexed about. But see, that's what happens. When we're prejudiced, our views, our mind gets muddy. We self-rationalize our biases. And he does that. More information even comes, God graciously. Now, while Peter was inwardly perplexed, behold, the men who were sent by Cornelius, having made inquiry for Simon's house, stood at the gate, and they called out to ask whether Simon, who was called Peter, was lodging there. Peter's on the roof. He hears his voice. Those are Gentile accents. Looks over the side. He sees Gentile clothes. There's a Gentile chariot out there. And so, okay, this might mean what God was talking about. And so he's pondering the vision, and I want to say, Peter, don't quit being perplexed, quit pondering. Just obey. Peter aggravates me the most because I think I'm like him the most. I do those gift tests, inventories, and assessments, and they always come back a Bible character that you might be like, and Peter's always in my group as a guy who talks too much, puts his foot in his mouth, and you know, tries to be a leader, and all that does is make him publicly look stupid. And that's him here again. I just want to say, man, just do it. You have to understand it. Jesus says take a long walk off a short pier. You take a long walk off a short pier. He knows better than you. And now the Spirit comes. So Jesus was speaking. Now while he was pondering the vision, the Spirit said to him, it's almost as if Jesus said, I'm done talking to him. Holy Spirit, you go. Well, that's bad theology. Don't erase that. That is Trinitarian heresy right there. So just forget I said that. Those were not the words I was looking for. But he comes and he says the same thing. He says, rise, or behold, the three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them. I love that he addresses the attitude. I don't want you to just go with those three men kicking and screaming out of duty. I want you happily, joyfully, humbly, willingly going with them. When you go with them from Joppa back to Caesarea, that 31 miles, don't make them sit in the back of the wagon. Don't, when they eat their ham sandwiches on the way. You happily, willingly go with these guys. We'll get into it more next week, but at this point, look at how Peter's viewing them in verse 28. This is some of what he's thinking here in verse 20 or 19. You yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. Which means back in verse 19, he was still saying, I'm not going to associate or visit anyone who's other. I viewed you as common and unclean. But it begins to click here as we read in verse 21, Peter went down to the men and said, I'm the one you're looking for. What's the reason for your coming? Why are you here? Why are you on my lawn? And they said, Cornelius, Gentile name. A centurion, even worse. But then the next part, God begins to break through. An upright and God-fearing man, Peter, who's well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation. He was directed by a holy angel to send for you to come to his house and to hear what you have to say. The one who's seeking God is going to get a message about Christ from the one who's disobeying and resisting God. How gracious of God. But he finally clicks in verse 23. So he invited them to be his guest. I tell you, all those nevers that I mentioned earlier is from same pattern as here. When Peter repents, he's all in. That's a good thing about Peter. He does some dumb things, and he can be stubborn, but when he's exposed, it's, I'm all in. Not only will I not look, come on in. Bring some of that bacon. We'll fry it up. You can not only come in my house, you come stay all night with me. Good for Peter. I'd love to see, it's not in here, again, preacher's imagination. I'd love to see the neighbors looking out the window, seeing those Gentile plates. Who is that? That Galilean came in over to Simon. Here goes a neighborhood, and he goes out to the mailbox, kind of get a closer look. The neighbor comes out, and Mordecai, what is that over there? I don't know, but that Galilean took three of them in the house. Jewish flight from the neighborhood. Puts for sale signs in the yard. What's it going to take for you to get over the hump of your prejudice? When will you stop self-righteously judging others and begin to welcome and to bring others close into the group? When will you start keeping people at arm's length because of their external lifestyle, your bad experiences, your personal preferences? And begin to, like God showed you grace and hospitality and generosity, you begin to extend it to others. I'm not saying that you have to believe everything they believe and live the way they live. Of course not. Many times you should not, depending on what the issue is. But God's heart should be our heart, that if a person's going to hear about Jesus Christ from us, we're going to have to overcome some natural barriers that we have in order to reach them. You know, they say when you get older, you get more deep set in your views. You get more conservative. You can become, as you get older, more closed off to change and adjustment. I'm finding as I get older, I'm getting more liberal. That's pure grace to me. That's not naturally who I am, my personality type. I'm not doing that on my own strength. In fact, I think a great gift to me in that regard is you. One of the means of sanctification in my area of prejudice is being your pastor. Because you're so gracious. You're so patient. You outdo me in kindness and mercy. I'm able to see by your in-my-office conversations and over coffee and in your homes and the emails and the stories that you're telling me, how much more you love Jesus and you're following Jesus in ways that are completely foreign to me. I'll say it this way, ways that I would never do it that way. And it at times can even drive me crazy that you are. And yet I'll see God blessing the socks off of it. That God is using you And you treat me the same way. I want to close with three things that I've learned. All of this under the banner. God's, isn't it good that God's a lot easier to get along with than I am or you are? He is. Three things. One, the root of prejudice is pride. At root, whatever your prejudice is, it's pride. That you know best, you are best. That the way you do it, and the way you feel and think and speak and act is the way. Everybody else is wrong. I don't know how the Holy Spirit spoke to Peter in verse 19, but when the Holy Spirit speaks to me, it sounds like Sarah Perry an awful lot. And this past week that happened again, I was having a conversation with my older son about something. I can't even remember what it was. It's how blind I am. But my older son said, well, Dad, what you need to do is, and something came on my face, or I looked at him in a certain way, and Sarah goes, oh, Dan, he'll never do it now. Now that you've said to do it, he's less likely to do it than ever because he don't like to be told what to do. Why? Because I'm proud. I'm right, you're wrong. I'm good, you're bad. I'm superior, you're inferior. I'm in, you're out. Pride is at the root of all our prejudices. Second, the consequences of prejudice is painful. Now that's obvious when we think of the people who are being oppressed or prejudiced or discriminated against, but I don't mean it that way. The consequences of prejudice are painful for you who are prejudiced. The most bitter, angry, destructive person in that exchange is the bigot. It hurts your relationship to God. It hurts your relationship to others who are in your group. Not just those who you're holding outside the group. And then third, not only is the root of prejudice pride and the consequences of prejudice painful, the freedom from prejudice is in Christ. Okay, that's where the freedom comes from. Don't hold me to any of this politically, but just to get the point across, to strip away wherever else you're putting your hope. It's not in you becoming more aware of others and their experience, although that might be helpful. Freedom will not come through reparations or education or budget. Freedom alone comes when the Holy Spirit comes in and radically transforms the human heart. That's the answer. There can be other means of helpfulness in a sinful, broken society that may or may not be politically advantageous. But we alone as Christians have the answer to prejudice and discrimination, and it is the person of Jesus Christ. That's why Galatians 3 says, for in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God. Through faith, for as many as you were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. That's where our unity must be found. Ephesians 2 14 through 16, Jesus himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, killing the hostility. That's the answer. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads and pray. And that's the action step. Whether you're a Christian or a non-Christian, that's the same action step. Get in your mind whatever that prejudice is that you have. You don't have to tell anybody. You don't have to write it down. It can just be between you and God. But whatever it was, that's the thing. I tell you, coming to Christ and bringing that to Christ will make all the difference. Alone. Because when we come to Him, it humbles us in our need so that we stop thinking higher about ourselves than we ought to think, and we think higher of others. It releases us from the feeling of having to prove ourselves or defend our position. It empowers us to love others as we have been loved, with mercy, gentleness, and grace. If you've never told God of your need for forgiveness for your sin, and if you've never received Jesus' death for it, do that right now. And He will bring you close right now. He'll give you a whole new life and begin to shape you into what He intends you to be. Father, I pray that all of us would do business in those deep, dark parts of our life that we want no one to know, and we bring them into Your light for cleansing and relief. And You set us free. I ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, and all God's people said.
As we transition into our time of communion, I want to bring back one of the very bold claims that Pastor Josh just said towards the end of the sermon, which is that Christianity alone, not in addition to, but alone, has the answers to the problems of prejudice for all the world. That's a very bold claim. Because there are a lot of proposed solutions to what we do in order to balance the scales, ensure equality, rid the world of prejudice. And for us to say that we have the answer requires a bold demonstration of that. Bold claims require bold proof. What you have before you is bold proof that we are the answer to that problem, that Christ is the answer to that problem. Because what you have before you is Jesus' invitation to partake of His own body and blood with no prejudice toward you. The one who had every right to be prejudiced toward you, Jesus Christ says, none of that. I deem nothing and no one common or unclean. And by extension, what that means is not a one of us can look at each other and say, you're common or unclean because of your race, because of your age, because of your abilities or inabilities. Whatever it is, all of us partake together of the body and blood of Jesus Christ as a demonstration, a bold demonstration, that we are one in Christ, that there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for we are all one in Christ. And so if you are a Christian this morning, partake of this bold demonstration that we are one together. And then go from here and show the world how we can be the answer.
Thank you.
Thank you again for joining us for worship this morning. If you are new or visiting this today, we'd love to connect with you. If you would be so kind as to fill out a Connect card that you might find in the back of the row there in front of you and take it to our Connect desk, we have some gifts for you and would answer any questions that you may have, and we'll follow up with you this week. We're going to do our benediction to send you out. Last week I was asked, it might be a good reminder, is what is this when you pronounce the benediction at the end? Nothing special about this. You don't have to do this. This is just a physical posture that some among us do, is represent their receiving the blessing and the grace that is pronounced over you. But if you're not comfortable doing that, the benediction still takes. It's still true. You can enjoy it and go. Almighty God, you sent your Son into the world not to condemn the world, but so that the world might be saved. May we, the people of Redemption Church, not other one another, but love one another with all kindness, charity, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, and truth of your Son, Jesus Christ. May our church be welcoming to people unlike us. May our homes be filled with people unlike us. May our hearts be open to people unlike us. Make us follow the way of our Lord, who rejected pride in his position and embraced humility in his death. Lead us in the way. We ask it in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Redemption Church said, amen. You're dismissed. Saturday.